This season of So Wrong It's Right is sponsored by our friends at Foxy Bingo. Are you looking for a fun online bingo experience all at the tip of your finger? Whether you're a seasoned bingo pro or a complete beginner, Foxy Bingo is the place for you. They've got bags of bingo to go around, plus loads of top slots that you can grab a pawful of. They have a huge range of free, classic, and exclusive games you can play with your mates and community chat, so you can always feel part of the Foxy pack. So get your fox on by heading to Foxy Bingo today. 18 plus, begambleaware.org, T's and C's apply.
I think this whole, like, you know, nepotism, nepo baby, like, it's such a dirty word. And actually, people don't realise how hard that is to hear about yourself on the receiving end of it.
No one's mad if, like, the owner, partner of a law firm gets his son in.
But, like,
when it's to do with entertainment, we just get so vicious.
So vicious. The most miserable times of my life were when I was in the spotlight. And the happiest times of my life are when it's just been me in my gym on my own.
Let's talk a little bit about James.
I don't think either of us ever would have predicted that we were going to break up, ever. I just remember being like, just saying it, like, I don't think that we should do this anymore.
Chloe, welcome to So Wrong It's Right.
Thanks for having me.
So happy to have you on the pod.
I'm so happy to be here.
I've got on my notes here, author, personal trainer, mother, podcast host, and obviously a part of the iconic Madeley family.
I know, right? Yeah, that's my biggest claim to fame.
The list goes on. Which one defines you best? Which one do you connect with most out of all those kind of...
The two that I really connect with most would probably be mother and, like, anything really in the health and fitness sphere. Yeah. I've been doing it 12 years now. Like, I'm really not being dramatic when I say that I started weightlifting because I fancied a boy, and he was a PT and a bodybuilder. And the second that he put an Olympic bar on my back and he taught me how to barbell back squat, I fell in love with it.
Yeah.
Like, it sounds so ridiculous, but it just was like that. It was instant. And I fell in love with it. And that was 12 years ago. And it just feels very viscerally like a part of who I am now. Mm. But if you told me 12 years ago, you're going to get bang into weightlifting, I would have, like, laughed my fucking ass off. Yeah, absolutely not. But it shocked me as much as everyone else. And it's been, like, I would say the biggest kind of narrative of my life over the last decade plus. But now I have Bodie, obviously, that's kind of bulldozed in. She's bulldozed in. And I would say that's now kind of the biggest, I suppose, soul-defining thing in my life.
Let's get into the fitness stuff, actually, right off the bat then. What was your relationship like with sport and fitness as a child, preteen? Like, were you a sporty kid?
No. I was the girl that bunked pee every week and said I had my period every week so that I didn't have to do it. I still don't enjoy team sport. Like, I'm a very anxious person. Mm-hmm. And in a team sporting environment, I feel a lot of pressure. And I really disliked it growing up. And I think in my school, and I think a lot of schools were, I don't know if they still are, quite similar, it was very much like football, netball, round. It was all team stuff. And I just naturally assumed, like, I don't really like sport, which, funnily, in hindsight, I obviously did, because I used to horse ride, I used to surf, like, I liked being on my own.
You like physical activity, but it wasn't those, like, team.
No, yeah. it was me for me. It's like almost like what people talk about when they talk about meditation now. It's kind of, I guess, what I love using my body. I'm very physically capable. I'm very lucky. I'm genetically good at physical stuff.
Yeah.
So then when I found weightlifting, I was like, as if, like, but I loved it. It was just... I just took to it like a duck to water. And then I got really interested in the science and the nutrition. I just started doing, like, as many diplomas and courses as I could. And I really think, like, in hindsight, when I look back, at the time where I found out, I was very much just known as Richard and Judy's daughter. And I only identified as that. And I was so unhappy. And I look back now and I'm like, thank God. Thank God that happened to me, because I think the last 12 years of my life would look markedly different to what they look like now.
Because you found a thing that's yours.
Yeah.
And that you make, like your soul connects with it.
Yeah, exactly.
And previous to that, were you looking for your thing that you loved and you hadn't, such a relatable situation to be in? So many people relate to that.
Yeah, I mean, I was in my early 20s, and it's a weird time, because you're like, oh shit, like, I've got to grow up. But I didn't know what I wanted to do. I assumed that I wanted to work in TV because that was the world that I'd grown up in. Mm-hmm. So my parents started this morning the year I was born. So I kind of, like, yeah, and I think this whole, like, you know, nepotism, nepo baby, like, it's such a dirty word. And actually people don't realize how hard that is to hear about yourself on the receiving end of it. When actually it's very common, whether your family works in law or if they work in medicine or if they work in entertainment, that you naturally follow their footsteps because that's the world you know. And that's the world you're kind of educated in. And it's actually quite a normal and I think visceral thing that happens. And yet people think that it's, I don't know, for me, I really struggled with that word growing up. I just, of course I went into TV. Like, of course, my brother did too for a period before he then went into talent management, which is also a part of our world. So I really struggled. And then I think finding what I found, finding my purpose, like you say, and you summed it up perfectly there, was, it defined me in a brilliant way. And I was very lucky that it happened to be something that in terms of physicality and hormonally was very good for my anxiety disorders. So yeah, I got very, very lucky. And I don't think that happens for everyone.
No, it definitely doesn't. And I think like you say, it can happen at any stage of life. And then when you find it, it's just such a great feeling. What does your kind of workout structure look like at the moment? How do you train? Like, when do you train?
So I train 5 days a week, Monday to Friday. I give Bodhi to the nanny. We have a part-time nanny who's great Monday through Friday. I give her to the nanny. I get to the gym. I work out within an hour. I'm done. And then I sit in the club room in my gym. And I just sit at my laptop and I work until I know I have to leave to get Bodhi. And then I go home and I get Bodhi. And then I have Bodhi all night, put her down for bath in bed. And then if Love Island's on, I'll watch Love Island, drink a glass of wine, go to bed, and then do it all again the next day. But like, actually, I'm one of those people who I need structure and routine.
Yes. Yeah.
Like my ex, and I think one of the reasons things became so hard for us that he thrives in chaos. Like his schedule, like I don't even remember the last time he was in England for a full week. Like he's all over the place and I just can't do that.
Can't
so like,
that.
No, but now I'm trying to figure out how I can get my social life back and have Bodhi and work and stuff. So that's a process as well.
I think it's also really cool that you submitted that you have help with Bodhi.
Oh, yeah.
Because so many people in the public eye like pretend that they're in the gym and they're doing all these things and then you're like, okay, but where's your baby? And it's like they pretend they're just doing it all, which I think then makes other mothers feel so like a failure because they're like, well, I don't have... How do you do that? Because I can't do that.
I want to be very, very clear. If you want to go back to work or you want to be in the gym, you know, training 2 hours a day, you need help.
Yeah.
It's that simple. And if you don't want to get help and you choose to kind of be present, omnipresent with your child until they start nursery or school, whatever, more power to you. But you absolutely cannot have both.
No.
And so every time you see a woman going about living her life or like me, you know, I run two businesses. I have help.
Yeah.
Now, I have part-time help because Bodhi's still so young. And again, like with everything that's been going on at home, it's been important to me that I spend time with her or I get very anxious about that.
Absolutely.
So that's important to me, but I have help. And I don't, I agree with you. I really, really hate it, especially when women who, you know, don't necessarily have children say you can have it all, you can have everything. What if you have a family and you have a career and you have a, so you can't, Matt, you can't have it all. Like, no. I can't be traveling around the summer, like all around Europe, sorry, all the summer, because like a lot of my friends are who don't have kids, because I have a kid.
Yeah.
I can't throw myself into 2-3 more big work projects like I used to do because I have a kid, and I can't be a stay-at-home mum because I have a job.
Yeah.
So you have to understand that. And, you know, it's, I think the judgment is just insane.
It's insane, the judgment, and it's also insane the expectation that you say, because it's like, if you're gonna then maintain a career of your own and that you say, how can you do that? And that means you might miss, like, you know, play group in the morning and someone else goes with them. Do you know what I mean? And that's, like you said, the trade-off that you have to make, which I guess is a hard one, but it'd be better if women were honest with each other about it.
100%. It's too much judgment, but that's being a woman.
You spoke about your love for weightlifting.
Mm.
I don't have the physique you do, but I'd also love to weight train. And I got into weight training years ago. It's so weird. I was just training fitness for a pageant.
Yeah.
And then I ended up doing a bodybuilding, like bikini entry level.
Yeah.
But not because I thought I was going to win, but my trainer was like, you should do it because it'll give you a goal to work towards.
That's
and that's
great.
How I got into my love for weightlifting.
Was it pro elite?
Yeah.
I know loads of people that did it. It's great. And it gets so many people into it.
And it's just such a, like, gives you such a target. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But so many women are still so afraid of the weight section. And it actually, like, it makes me really sad because I'm like, once you get it, and you get that you are not going to look like a bodybuilder, unless you are eating these insane amounts of protein and you're supplementing or whatever, you won't accidentally wake up ripped.
No.
Like, what would be your advice to women who want to get into weightlifting but they're scared?
It's really funny, and you absolutely nailed it there. It's like, first of all, we don't have enough testosterone to get jacked. It doesn't happen. If you feel like, you know, you're weightlifting, or you know somebody who's weightlifting and they're starting to look a bit bulky, that's body fat. Like, I'm about 3 kgs heavier in terms of body fat now than I normally am. So I'm bigger than I normally am. I lift weights, you see that. But, you know, if you come down a little bit in body fat, that's how you get the toned look.
Yeah.
People go, no, I don't want to lift weights, I just want to get toned. It's like, yeah, but that's resistance training and a lower body fat. It's called body composition, and that's how you do it. So those are the kind of the main kind of fears. This has been proven to be the best thing you can do for your body in terms of all-cause mortality, you know, in terms of if you are aging, in terms of if you are pregnant, if you're going through the menopause, if you are struggling with insulin resistance. The best thing you can do for your body is resistance training.
Yeah.
And yet we're asking women if it's worth it, essentially, for their health, because of how they might look. It's depressing and it's ridiculous. Now, the narrative is changing, and especially with everything Davina McCall's doing for the menopause at the moment, people are starting to realize how important it is to do this specific modality of training as you age, you know. And I will say, like, also, if you're like me and you do struggle with kind of anxiety disorders that, you know, obviously we talk about cortisol and insulin, and adrenaline, it's a really nice way to channel that and harness it before going down other kind of routes. So I just am like, obviously, I'm a massive champion of it. And your physique is amazing. I've seen many photos of you in a bikini and you look banging.
Thank you very much. No, you're so right. And I'm like, I'm not a PT. I've not got any qualifications, but I'm a big, like, health, like, fitness junkie. And like you say, skeletal muscle mass. Mm-hmm. I don't know, you all know the percentage, but if you have a good amount of skeletal muscle, your, you know, mortality against any disease, injury, anything.
Yeah.
And like, people just undermine it to, like, just the way you look.
I know.
It's so much more important than that.
No,
to have muscle.
Yeah. It's so embarrassing. I mean, yeah, you're talking everything from cancer to surviving cancer treatment to surviving a fall to osteoporosis, sarcopenia, arthritis. I mean, the list is endless. And it is depressing when women sit there and go, yeah, but do you want to look like a man? It's like, well, A, you're not going to.
No.
And B, what are you talking about? Yeah. Like, can we level up a bit?
I know. You're so 100% right.
Thanks, babe.
You touched there on nepotism and the whole conversation around that, and I think it's such an interesting one, and it was very kind of honest of you to just come out with that. What was your experience like? You know, I know you've been probably asked this question a million times, being raised by, you know, the king and queen of daytime TV. And I just have to do this sometimes on my pod, because some of the listeners and watchers, Gen Z and younger, younger than Gen Z, will be like, what's this you're talking about? Alpha, is that what they are?
Are they?
Richard and Judy, like you say, were the it couple. I mean, they still kind of are, but off TV. And, you know, the year you were born, they were the This Morning hosts.
Yeah.
For how long did they have that job for?
I think, well, they did move to Channel 4.
And then they had their own show, didn't they?
16 years they did This Morning. And then when I was 21, my mum specifically retired. But then they did the Channel 4 show, the evening show.
Yes. And then your dad is still popping up on GMB.
Yeah, GMB.
And different things.
Yeah.
What was that experience like growing up, like, literally as a baby, from the day you were out the womb and they were, you know, on your telly?
So again, you know, they started it the year that I was born. So it is literally, I have nothing to compare it to.
Yeah.
So, you know, what I will say, it was like fucking amazing that when I was obsessed with the Spice Girls at 9 years old, I got to meet them. Like, I would lie in bed at night and cry. Like, what if I never get to meet the Spice Girls? A very dramatic teeny bopper child. And I got to meet them, and like, so much so, like, I walked past Emma Bunton in the street the other day and she was like, hi, Chloe. And I was like, it's the coolest thing in the world.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it was wicked. And like, loads of fun stuff happened. Like, George Michael came over for Sunday lunch once. And I remember my mom having a meltdown. Yeah, as you do. Like, really cool stuff. It was never, because my mom grew up very working class Manchester. My dad grew up very working class Romford, Essex. And so it was never lost on them. So because their excitement and their shock at what what was happening to their lives was so evident and talked about. And like my mum, like literally did a somersault when she heard George Michael was coming over for Sunday lunch. And it was the result of him donating a lot of money for a charity phone in they did. And they were like, look, he wouldn't let them say who it was. They were like, we really want to thank you. Come over for Sunday lunch. And shock, he said yes. And
wow,
it was a huge, huge, huge deal. So it was really exciting for me too. And also let's not, you know, lie about the elephant in the room. It has had a huge impact on me having like the audience that I have on social media, which has then allowed me to have a direct audience to market to in terms of my health and fitness stuff. So no, my parents have nothing to do with health and fitness, and no, you can't say that it's nepotistic. But what I can say is that because of my career in television before, I had a built-in audience on social media, and that makes doing whatever you go into next easier.
But when I see narratives around like the Beckham's kids, they fucking, whoever else, I honestly think it's the stupidest argument, because like you say, if you were them, would you not? Like you say, also no one's mad if like the partner of a law firm gets his son in.
Yeah.
But like when it's to do with entertainment, we just get so vicious. So vicious. And it's like, what do you want that human who didn't choose their parents? You don't choose your parents. What do you want them to do? Just stay indoors and knit because you're pissed off that they got like the door like opened a little bit for them. It just doesn't make any sense to me.
No, like, you're right. You're right. Nobody judges it in dentistry or in law or in medicine. But when it comes to the entertainment industry, people get very angry, and they get angry because, let's be honest, and especially, I mean, I think this has always been the case, but especially now with people like the Kardashians and everything, people see fame as a measure of success. Now, I'm here to tell you it is not.
That's a very true point.
Yeah. And so I completely disagree with that, you know, sentiment, but they do, and it makes them feel angry. But I can tell you now, like, you know, for any of those kids or famous people who've kind of done what I've done, like dipped in and out of it, like the most miserable times of my life were when I was in the spotlight. And the happiest times of my life have when it's just been me in my gym on my own. It's not a measure of success at all. And I've made much more money doing what I do now than I did when I worked in TV. There is actually no money in TV for anyone who wasn't.
Why
clear
do you think
on
I'm
that.
Here, guys?
There really isn't. Unless they get their shit together and they start getting, you know, sponsorships and branding the way that YouTube do. TV's on its out, which they're doing now, but still, like, yeah, it's a very misguided anger, hatred, and argument, in my opinion.
Yeah, and it doesn't make any sense. It's a very different argument, but it's almost like the same people like to go, oh, well, yeah, but you got that because you're on Love Island. It's like, so things can, like, open doors for people. Also, once you're in the door, you can only stay off yourself.
Yeah,
like, 100%. They can't keep you... famous parent or a show to launch or whatever definitely helps.
Yeah.
But then once you're there, you have to create the space, because otherwise it's like, we'll put you on the show because you went on this or your parents that, but they're not going to book you again if you're an uninteresting, uncharismatic person.
That's exactly it. You have to work hard no matter what industry you fall into or the door is open for you. You have to work hard. Yeah. You can't just be like on Love Island and come off and then maintain or even grow and metastasize what you've done without working your socks off, being a creative mind, not having a vision of where you want to go and what you want to do. You have to work. And it's the same in my industry. Like, I talk about treading water since having my daughter. Like, trust me, like, if I hadn't been doing that, I would be making a lot more money right now and a lot more people would know what I do for a living. But it's not the right time for me, so it's fine. But it works for everything. You're completely right.
Hi, Huns, it's Liv, and welcome to this week's What the Foxy Trends, brought to you by Foxy Bingo. I have two current trending styles, and I'm going to give my opinions on them. Let's do it. Okay, number one, rugby shirts. So rugby shirts are making a comeback. It's a Jack Wills kind of feeling with the stripes and the collar. I actually like it. I'm not like obsessed, but I don't hate it. I think there's a place, I think it looked quite cool, quite preppy, quite slow-y. Do you remember when people used to say that? So yeah, I'm fine with it. Number two, cherry red themed outfits. I was on the cherry red thing before it was even a thing. I love the color red. I love red accents in clothing. I think it's chic. I think it's timeless. It's cute. It's feminine. I'm all for a cherry red accent. And actually, that's going to be my next nail color, I feel. Guys, that was this week's What the Foxy Trends, brought to you by Foxy Bingo. I will see you next week. Let's talk a little bit about James. We won't dwell on it too much, but James Haskell, who is your
Well, he's actually still technically my husband.
Your husband.
Technically,
you
yeah.
are separated.
We're
from.
Separated, yeah.
And you've been, how long have you been separated for now?
Oh my God, like, I'll just be honest, like exactly a year.
Really?
We kind of, when we released the statement, like, yeah, it was, we kind of started to have the conversation in August of last year. And we kind of really, obviously, as I think people think it's like a specific date, you know, yeah. as the weeks, days, weeks, months pass, it becomes more farmed up. You know, you realize nobody's fighting for this and you realize that like, you're getting more and more serious about this thing that you're just talking about initially. Mm. And so slowly, slowly it kind of, it dissipated. But the first conversation started happening in August last year.
And was it something that you, like you said, you kind of see it coming? You both just like, was it on both sides? Were you like, this just isn't gonna...
I think I knew that I was really unhappy and I think he knew that he was really unhappy too. But I don't think either of us ever would have predicted no. that we were going to break up, ever. And I swear to God, it was just like one day, I remember exactly where we were. I remember the day, the time, the temperature, the outfits, where we were, everything. I just remember being like, just saying it, like, I don't think that we should do this anymore, but really meaning it.
Yeah.
And it kind of went from then, like I say, like it doesn't just happen. Like people are like, this is when we decided. It didn't for us anyway. It was built upon and it was farmed up as time passed. And it's still like that now. Mm. Like there's still moments now. There are still moments where we kind of boomerang a bit. Like what happened recently? I can't remember what happened recently. But oh, he moved out. Just this tiny thing. Him moving out the house. And that was like a boomerang moment where you kind of have to relive it again. Mm. And that was really interesting. And then we were both at Glastonbury and we ran into each other. And that was like quite surprisingly for me. I didn't see it coming. Like a boomerang moment because I was with all of our mutual friends and he was with his like kind of more DJ friends. And that was a weird moment. So you kind of relive it sometimes.
You're like, oh, here's this person I like have a child with. And I'm married to and I was like bumping into you.
And like 11 years. Yeah. Like 11 years.
It's a long
like,
time. That is,
I've like basically kind of grown up into adulthood with him, basically. So there are still boomerang moments. You know, you still kind of, you build, it's like building bricks. You build on that kind of solidity and certainty of this decision as time passes. But, you know, it was never just instantaneous. James and I, we're really good friends. I just want to be clear.
Yeah.
We don't work together romantically. We do work as friends, by and large. We do work as friends. We're very good friends. We spend loads of time together. Me, him and Bodhi are often at Sunday lunch together. Yeah. He was with me on my birthday with her to kind of basically be the parent while I got drunk.
Yeah, love that.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, obviously we spent Bodhi's birthday together and we're very good friends. And I think and I hope that over time that's only going to get like we're only going to get closer and better in that specific regard of being friends. So, you know, actually we made the right decision. We're happier and we're closer in many ways now than we were then.
So life is co-parenting, a little daughter. Are you dating?
No.
Is that really awesome?
No, I'm not dating. I'm like talking to people.
Okay, so you're sort of starting to dip your toe back into that
Yeah,
plunge.
I'm dipping my toe back into the kind of, I guess, flirting, I'm single pond.
I'm asking because I'm wondering what it's like to navigate it because like, you've not been single for 10 years.
Oh, I don't know what
like,
I'm doing.
Like, the landscape is...
completely different.
Yeah.
10 years, 11 really, and everyone now is like, okay, so I don't have a type. I go for people that I have a vibe and an energy with. You know, when you're just like, well, you're fucking fit. Like, that's what I want, right? Mm. The problem is now is that everybody meets people on dating apps, right? But you can't get a vibe or a feeling like that. It's very much like, here's four pictures. 9 times out of 10, there's guys hugging their dog because they think we love that. Mm. And then it's...
I won't be fair.
And then I'm just like, I get it. You have a dog. Like, it's every guy. I wonder half of them are like prop dogs. But I'm just like, standing borrowed. Yeah, for profiles and stuff. Like, this, by the way, just to be clear, me and my friend maybe got a little bit drunk last week and we downloaded a few apps and we've been kind of laughing. I'm not active on them at
this
all.
This is fun, though,
but
to
we
do
like
that.
To do this, yeah, like, laugh at it, basically take the piss out of everyone because I'm not ready to date yet. But I can't see myself actually being active on any of these, you know, apps because I'm like, that's not how I fancy people.
No.
I get bored talking to someone I haven't met. Like, I'm just a bit like, okay, like, just spend 1,000, you know, WhatsApps a day.
No,
like,
I'm
not interested in adding someone I don't know into the mix. So I'm really hoping that I meet someone IRL, but we'll see.
No, that'd be the best way. honestly, everyone pretty much that I've ever been with has laughed me into bed. So I don't know how that would translate to a dating app. Because can you be laughed into bed off a dating app?
I mean, I think that like they make some funny one-liners.
And then you're like, yeah, are you funny? Have you got a good personality? Yeah, like, shall I meet you in real life? Then what if you're...
Yeah, and then you kind of like don't really... Like one guy, like my main photo on this thing is a filtered photo. And there's one guy who liked it. His handle is like, I won't like you if you filter your photos. And I'm like, got ya.
We were just discussing this at lunch, weren't we? We were just discussing this. And also you just know he's going to be a pain in the ass. Yeah, like, what guy writes that? Let's have our filters piss off. You have patriarchy. Yeah. We have filters.
Exactly. Like, this is the thing. I'm like, any sentence like that where they're basically bashing a woman really,
this is a bad
really rubs me up the wrong way. Yeah.
Big
like,
red flag.
There's loads of stuff like that. It's like, I don't like it if you wear too much makeup. And I'm like, fuck off. Absolutely not. No.
Don't talk about clothing, hair. Just don't.
Just leave it. Just don't. Why do you care?
Yeah.
Like, and shut up, point to me at any Hollywood actress that you fancy. She wears makeup.
Oh, no, but my favourite is when they're like, oh, I'm really into like supernatural women. And then they'll name someone who's had like every cosmetic procedure. Done. I'm like, she's just been done really well.
Yeah,
like,
I know.
You just hate to break it. I don't like, burst your balloon, but nothing's real.
I completely agree with you. I back this 100%.
You said you're not ready to date yet and stuff, but what do you imagine the future looking like for you and Bodhi? Like, what would, you know, if you were dating again, what would a partner look like? What are the ticks? And
he would probably have to have kids.
Or his own already.
Yeah, I don't think
so. He could get it.
I need someone to get it. I'm from a blended family. Two of my brothers were from my mum's first marriage, but I never felt like they were my brothers.
Just
like
your brothers.
We're family. That's it. You know. So I get that it can. I've seen it work firsthand, and I've loved in that environment and been loved in that environment. I think he'd have to have kids. I can't imagine dating someone or talking to someone who, like, it's almost like, I don't know, it would feel awkward to me to be like, oh, I can't, I'm seeing my, or like, oh yeah, no, they'd have to have kids.
So that they could get it.
Yeah.
You don't want them like, oh, I've got to go rock climbing and pet my dog and take selfies of my dog. And you're like, okay, I just got to look after this human that I made.
Yeah, exactly. So, I'm like, no, I like, again, I love dogs. It's just like, come on, guys, there's more. So that to me is a huge thing. And I also think like, I just think that men who have had children have maybe a little bit of a different perspective on some things, especially if they have little girls. That would be the dream.
Yeah.
They have a different perspective on things, and I think I would really like that. I think I'd be attracted to that.
Yeah, because you are very like an empowered woman, and you're very much for women, and you know, and women's rights, and everything like that. And has that ramped up since having a daughter of your own? And
yeah, it's crazy that I don't even see it happening, and then all of a sudden, like, I'm stopping on the high street trying to give teenage girls a lift home. So I'm like, you ain't walking home in that outfit. Get in the car now.
was you like 10 years ago.
Oh my god, I was the worst. Like when Playboy Bunny and the showing thong was a thing.
Oh,
stop with
god,
that. I'm so happy I didn't get
that
bunny
too.
Tattoo. Oh god, so yeah, like all of a sudden I do have like this weird maternal instinct which randomly will show up sometimes. But what I love about Bodhi, I kind of love it that she's inherited James's ballsy zero fucks given personality, because on a little girl living in London, I kind of need her to be like that.
Yeah.
So I'm really happy about that. And you know, the goal with James and I and my whole family is just to surround her with so much love and support. You know, my parents always used to say to me when I was growing up, as long as you're happy and healthy, we're happy.
Mm.
And like, that's all I want. And I just want her to feel free and empowered to do whatever she wants, and safe. I just want her to feel safe. Because if she feels safe, she'll feel free and empowered to do whatever she wants.
Yeah. That's so lovely. And that's such a good point as well. You say like feeling safe is, I think, such an undervalued, sounds like kind of like obviously you want to be safe and not in danger, but like the feeling of safety. Yeah.
I look back on my life. If my parents, I mean, I don't know how you've done it. And I always say this, especially to people who are coming off of big shows like Love Island and they're thrust into the spotlight. I don't know how you've handled that without having your family guide you through it. Because like I was taught when I was like 5 years old what to do if we were doorstepped or if I saw journalists going through the bins, and like, I have like a very kind of hardened knowledge of this industry and how everything works. And that I credit that safety to me not going fucking mental when I was a teenager. Because if I'd been famous without my family doing it, like if I'd actually achieved something, well, then I would have really struggled to handle that.
No, so I just picked up on you saying that.
No, but seriously, I would have really, really struggled. So credit to you for handling it. I totally get why celebrities crumble under it. It can be awful. It can be soul destroying. And I just, and what that brings me back to have a point here, is that feeling of safety that I was okay. It was going to be okay. And at the end of the day, I had like a port in the storm, and that was my family. And I want to give that to her so much.
Chloe, we're going to play the box of wrong.
Okay.
But in the box, there are just random little statements, musings that my lovely producer surprised me with. And we'll decide if they're wrong, right, or so wrong, they're right. Okay, so what is your so wrong, it's right?
Okay, my so wrong that it's right is pretending to be asleep so you don't have to play with your toddler.
And does she give in, or does she just keep going?
She gives in eventually. You really have to like put some like, you know,
you commit
dead
it.
Horse into it. Yeah. And then she'll crack on and she'll get bored of trying to wake me up and go do something else. And I'm like, oh, thank God. Leave me hungover and alone in peace.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Not the same. And I'm not great, but I do actually do that with my dog quite a lot. There's one dog, Lola, that you listen to the pod, you know about Lola. She's quite high maintenance, hun. And she, if I'm napping on the sofa, which is a very rare thing, I'll open one eye and her face will be like this close to me, just staring. So I just, and she'll kind of nudge me. But yeah, it's basically she wants me to take her out for the 15th time that day.
Yeah.
Okay, should we get into it?
Let's go.
Giving out fake numbers to avoid a awkward situation.
Oh, yeah. So wrong, it's right.
It's so wrong, it's right. But I don't know if I've ever actually done it.
Oh, I've done it.
Because you have to panic, think, change a few numbers, make sure you get enough numbers.
I had a situation where I did that and then the guy called me so I had his number. And then he was like, but it's fine. You just lie again. Oh, you just keep lying. Keep lying until you're out of the situation. He's like, oh, did you give me a fake number? I was like, no, let me look again. I'd be like, oh, sorry, I put in 7, not an 8.
Yeah, and then run.
Yeah.
So wrong, it's right.
Don't call me.
Name dropping.
I love it when other people name drop because it makes the story so interesting.
So do I.
So wrong, it's right.
Yeah, I agree because like we give people heat for it. But if I'm at a dinner party and I hear a couple of like famous names, suddenly my ears are like, when did you meet Britney?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I'm like, it's so interesting. Leaving a voice note that's over 3 minutes long.
I mean, okay, so I do this to people, but I don't like it when people do this to me. So I'm just going to say wrong.
Over
it's so
3 minutes?
I mean, I sent my best friend a voice note this morning, I think was like 5.5.
That's a podcast.
I know.
I'd quite like a voice note because when I'm getting ready in the morning, I play voice notes for my friends.
Too, yeah.
It's quite nice. But when I see like 1 minute 50, I'm a bit like, oh, really? Like, you know, and I put it on double times, just like,
it depends on the friend. Like it's some true. Of my friends have got, I'm here to listen to every word they have to say. And some of them I'm like, she's like, oh, sorry, I just saw a cute dog.
Yeah, no.
No.
Okay, so wrong. This, right?
Yeah.
Or wrong. Flirting with someone just to get free drinks. I'm just going to go out on the limb and say, I still do that and I'm married.
I'm going to say.
If there's a drink in it, like I'm
going to say, so wrong, it's right. But my thing, and I don't know if this is like a bit of a weird thing, is like I'm scared to flirt with anyone I'm not interested in because then I feel like if it goes somewhere, you're like expected to swap a number or go home with them. Do you know what I mean? So I just kind of don't really play that game because it puts me in a weird situation.
There is a bit of an expectation, especially with English guys. I feel like the American culture is so different. They're just like, oh my God, here, do you want a bottle of vodka? Like, and then we're like, oh, have a good night, bye. And we're like, oh my God, like, if that was an English dude, he'd be like taking your house address,
yes,
like
100%.
Your debit card details. If you're not sleeping with me, you need to make a transfer for half the bottle.
Yeah.
I mean, if I'm at the bar and like someone's like, you know, buying drinks, I mean, I've got my own money. I don't even know what it's about, but I'll be like, oh yeah, have a drink. And
I just
scuttle off.
I love you for that. Yeah, but they're probably like texting their mates on WhatsApp, like, fucking Olivia, I just bought Olivia
she's
out
like,
with a drink.
So trying to cheat on her husband right now. And I'm like, no, I just quite bothered to dig out my debit card. Yeah. Asking someone attractive to help you in the gym, even though you're perfectly capable of setting it up yourself.
Oh, so wrong, it's right. I do this all the time. I find excuses to talk to the fit boys in my gym, of which there are many all the time. But like, I think they're all like, nobody's interested in me in my gym. It's really sad because it would be so easy.
I doubt that.
It would be such an, no, I could not make it more obvious when I fancy someone in the gym because I feel like that's why I'm really confident. That's my zone.
That's your place.
Yeah. And like, they're always like a bit flirty banter. There's always a bit of like back and forth, but like, yeah, never anything more than that. I'm like, damn it. I'm not packing what these guys are wanting.
What are they wanting?
I don't know, but it's not me.
Oh, I refuse to believe it. Oh, Irish goodbye. Leaving a party without saying goodbye.
So wrong, it's right. Always do it every
Me
time.
Me too.
Yeah.
I saw something that people would do that save like...
Yeah, hours in their year.
Weeks or out of your life or something.
Yeah.
And especially if people are drinking. It's different if you're maybe like at a dinner party or whatever. Like to go to the toilet and not come back is a bit odd. But
yeah.
a party where anyone's drinking, you don't need to tell them you're leaving.
No, especially when you're stood up and everyone sat down. It's like, oh, you Just have to go. Do like a...
Be awkward. Oh my God, you're like... Yeah, Brad's very like say goodbye to everyone. Like if he had his way, it just takes so long.
It's so boring.
It's just got...
I didn't even do it at my wedding. I was like, I'm going to bed.
Oh, I did.
I did. Yeah, I was like, bye.
I just scuttled off.
Yeah.
Wow. It's been a pleasure.
I've loved it.
I'm so glad you came on.
Thank you.
And I already liked you and what I knew of you and everything, but you're so articulate and such an open, honest person.
Thank you.
Mate for a great guest.
Thank
and
you.
A wonderful human.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I agree. Ditto. Yay.
This season of So Wrong It's Right is sponsored by our friends at Foxy Bingo. Are you looking for a fun online bingo experience all at the tip of your finger? Whether you're a seasoned bingo pro or a complete beginner, Foxy Bingo is the place for you. They've got bags of bingo to go around, plus loads of top slots that you can grab a pawful of. They have a huge range of free, classic, and exclusive games you can play with your mates and community chat so you can always feel part of the Foxy Pack. So get your fox on by heading to Foxy Bingo today. 18+, begambleaware.org, T's and C's apply.